everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Rambling Through Everyday Life with Fran and Angela. My name is Fran, and I am one of the co-hosts for this podcast. In this week's show, we talk about the Christmas shopping status. Listen, you've either got your feet up on the couch living your best life because you are D-O-N-E done, or you're probably like a whole lot of other people still running around trying to get all the things done. There is one wonderful gift you can always give every year if you are desperately searching for something beautiful and unique. It's the amaryllis. Angela shares a little bit about that. I also talk about, again, a book that I am slowly reading, and I highly, highly, highly recommend it for the right person in your life. It is called The Lord is My Courage. I talk about who this book is perfect for and why I love it so much. We spend a little bit of time, tiny bit of time, talking about the year 2022. And then finally, we talk about how to navigate grace and growth in people around you that, you know what, guys, we cannot control people's growth and their journey with the Lord. We just can't. So how do we encourage others? How do we live this out well? This is a wonderful encouragement. We've got one more episode for you guys this year, and that will be next week, where we are truly just talking about Christmas and what this time of year means to us. And then that's it. We'll be done until whenever we come back in January. We love you guys so much. Enjoy this week's show. And as always, let us know what you think. Have a great day. Okay, everybody. Another episode, another probably non-Christmas episode.
Throw a little Christmas in there.
We will. Okay, I hope we will, because I have so much to do still, mm-hmm. which we're going to hopefully finish up our shopping on this weekend, but when we're recording this, Christmas is 2 weeks away. Mm-hmm.
December 13th is this release date, so we're getting there quickly.
Holy moly, everybody.
So when you say shopping, like, how do you shop for a lot of people?
No.
Or has your circle gotten small? Who all do you shop for?
Yeah, our circle is small. It's just the kids, and we don't buy for the grandparents anymore just because the age of our parents. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're over 80.
It's so hard to know what to get people.
They just want time with us and to have a meal. So that's okay. It's literally just the kids. And we quit doing all the other cousins, and we don't do that anymore.
It's just too much.
It is too much. And they're all in their 20s. And so you wouldn't dare purchase anything for anybody. So it's just the kids, but they're hard, and they're all boys.
They are, and the thing that makes me a little sad, like the big kid in me, is the older my kids, I guess it's everybody's kids, the older they get, it's like you spend more money on smaller items.
No, for sure. Good grief. I went to Lululemon and bought the guy's pants. I said to somebody yesterday, I didn't mind spending, I'm not going to tell you, because if you don't know, then you might just be like, you're not my friend anymore. But if you know Lululemon and you know the cost, well, I bought a pair of joggers, mm-hmm. and some dress pants. Well, it's worth it. Absolutely worth it. But like, if I had a daughter and had to pay that for a pair of leggings,
it's ridiculous.
Oh my gosh. I'm not judging a single person, but I'm like, okay. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing that. I don't have girls. But I just think leggings are different than dress pants.
Yes.
And so that's just a little different justification in my brain. But leggings? No.
Well, and, you know, again, the kid in me, like, to make their Christmas about me for a minute.
Right.
Like, the kid in me wants to buy things that are fun for me to wrap and watch them unwrap.
Right.
Now Cole is into it. He wants symbols.
Oh, gosh.
Which, you know, pray for us. Mm. I saw something on, it was on somebody's story that said, I never understood why the little drummer boy's mama made him go out. Did you see that?
I
made him
that.
Go out into the cold, dark night to play the drums.
Yeah.
Until my child came home with a recorder. Mm-hmm. That's how I feel about this
drum
set.
Well, Little Drummer Boy, that's a song that we sung for years with Travis Cottrell in choir, and it would make me cry every time because it's so powerful. It's so beautiful. The lyrics are unbelievable.
But when I read that meme, I was like, that's funny.
Where was your mother?
Yeah, where was your mother?
So Cole wants like a kick pedal and some cymbals for his drum set.
That's great, though.
But we have Atlas, who is so into monster trucks.
And how old is he?
He is three. Mm-hmm. He's perfect age for all these things, except there's no elf in our house.
Yeah,
there's
praise
no,
God.
Mm-hmm, none of that. But it is fun to have a little one.
Yeah.
Every day he walks in and says, honey, did you wrap my presents?
Oh.
And no matter whose presents are under the tree, I'm like, yes, Atlas, everything is just for you. Nobody else even matters.
He can't read no name tag on that present.
Oh, it makes him happy.
Name tag, whatever it's called, gift tag.
Whatever it is.
Whatever.
Some years I just take a Sharpie and write on the present.
For sure. Nobody cares.
Nobody cares.
Nobody cares.
Okay, I saw something that you posted that I want to ask you about.
Oh, gosh.
You have a beautiful dining room table.
Oh, yes.
Ready for Christmas.
Yes.
Way to go, Fran.
I got that. I mean, that's something that I have inherited from my mother. I know that nowadays people are like, oh, paper products. But I think that as your family ages and you consider what you're passing down to them as far as memories go, I like that memory. And
sweet.
I want that memory of them to have that, we not only sat around the table together, that's easy, but it's just I'm not making it spiritual by any means. It's just that it's just lovely, and it's Christmas, and it's once a year, and I have this beautiful Christmas china that I love, so why not?
I love it. Here's my goal. You ready for my goal for the week?
Uh-huh.
Kaylee comes home on Thursday. This coming Thursday is the last day of exams for both my kids. Mm-hmm. Kaylee will be home. We sat at the table in the dining room last night, probably for the first time since Thanksgiving break when she was home. And I realized that I still have that hybrid that I posted. It's still Thanksgiving and Christmas in my dining room.
Time to fix that.
It's time to put the turkeys away.
Yep.
So my goal for myself, I don't have Christmas china, but even if it's just like, let's put the turkeys back in the attic.
Oh, for sure.
I want to create that ambiance for my children.
Do you have glassware of any kind?
I don't. Really, I have like some platters that have like Santa that I've used for centerpieces and things, but I do have some like the chargers with the napkins and the table runner. And
well, just decorate it for Christmas. You don't have to have the dishes.
Yeah, it just needs to be red and green and not also brown and gold.
No brown and orange. Those days are gone.
The turkey needs to get where does the turkey go? Santa goes back to the North Pole. Wherever the turkeys go,
he's going there.
He's got to go.
Bubba.
It's time for him to leave. Okay. What else? What's going on
this week?
I don't
know. I don't have a single thing other than my goal is to have Christmas shopping done in just a couple of days.
Yes. So y'all let us know if you're listening how your Christmas shopping is going.
Does it stress? Like, I know it stresses people out.
Mm-hmm.
I know it does because it's that weird thing of this is Christmas. It's so beautiful. It's so sacred. Our little hearts are so tender and full towards the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the exact same time, it's chaos.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just you're constantly ping-ponging back and forth.
Mm-hmm. You want the stillness and the experience Advent, but there's so much to do.
There's so much to do.
And you're whittling down, like, what really has to be done.
No.
And then there's always, like, that one person that's just really hard to buy for, or the unexpected gift giver where they give you something and you're empty-handed.
Oh, jeez.
So.
Yes, that's
I tell
me.
You what, I go to Hattie's. Marcy, if you're listening, we love your Hattie's is a local gift shop. They are so good at just random, cute.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody loves it.
All across the board on the price range. Mm-hmm. They'll wrap it for you.
It's fantastic.
And I love local.
Yes.
And there's a bazillion, but just if you can shop local. I know it's so easy to order things online, and we've all done it, and we have done it for this Christmas, but we always want to support local.
Mm-hmm. Always. Mm-hmm. And the amaryllis I bought me.
Oh,
I was at Trader Joe's over Thanksgiving break. And they had an amaryllis sale.
Oh, of course they did.
And it bloomed yesterday.
Oh, I love it so much.
It always blooms just on the day when you need a little extra.
Amazes me.
Do you remember 2 years ago it bloomed in March, the day my daddy died?
I do.
It was just
phenomenal.
Precious. Mm-hmm. So amaryllis, if you're listening and you need a gift that's just universal.
Yeah.
And it's sweet. There's a story behind it.
I know it.
Christy Nockels, look
we'll
it up.
We'll link to that.
Yeah.
Something about the amaryllis, even if it's just Google.
Because when you also tell the story of the amaryllis and can point them to the Christy Nockels song, it sounds like you've really put a lot of thought
into
this heartfelt gift. You're not just handing them a $6 flower.
That's right.
Bonus points.
Bonus.
For that. Okay, you want to talk about your book?
Yeah.
You got anything else?
Yeah.
Fran is reading a book that she's talked about on the podcast. I've ordered it for myself and also gifts for people in my family. This would make a fantastic Christmas gift.
Well, I need to give some context for the book. It's not an easy read.
Which is interesting because it's short mm-hmm. in chapters, but mm-hmm. but
If you're watching this, I mean, this is how slow I'm reading it, and I will go back and read it again because it's so powerful and it's so beautiful. It's called The Lord is My Courage. I've referenced it a little bit here and there. The subtitle is Stepping Through the Shadows of Fear Toward the Voice of Love. The context of the storyline is, yes, the author is taking us through Psalm 23. Literally, as I look at the contents, you can see, Angela, as I'm showing it to you, it's just a few words at a time that make up each chapter.
And literally, like one chapter is the Lord. The next chapter is my shepherd. Like mm-hmm. she really does.
Literally breaks it
word
down.
Word by word.
So it's a biblical study about Psalm 23, but she's also, the narrative is her story of her and her husband and them experienced church hurt. They were on staff at a church and just went through a very difficult time in ministries. But that is not like as I read it, I'm not like caught up in like what happens next.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't tell the story that way. It's just giving you context for how she took this psalm and applied it to their personal story. So it's not like, oh, I don't want to read about church hurt. No. That's not what this is about. It is.
Who would this be good for?
I think this is good for anybody that has just suffered, which we all have, but if you're coming out of any kind of difficulty, or you're in the middle of, not coming out of, if you're in the middle of or fresh out of any kind of suffering, difficulty, or pain of any kind, it doesn't have to be church because that's just kind of like a little, it's the narrative, but it's not the main narrative. The psalm is the main narrative. So I got to the chapter that is familiar, and you are going to have to listen to me read some of this to you. But we're all familiar with Psalm 23, and this is the portion of the psalm where it says, "Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Okay, so bear with me. I'm putting my readers on, and I'm going to read some of this to you. Because this book just ministers to your sweet little soul. It's so encouraging. This is not a light, happy, fun read. This is a book that ministers to your soul. So it's you've got to be careful about who you give it to because some mm-hmm. people would pick it up and be like, not interested
mm-hmm.
because of the narrative, because of the story.
But if anybody's been hurt
mm-hmm. in any way,
there is so much comfort in knowing that you're seen in that pain.
Yeah. Okay. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. I am truly reading the author's words here. This line of Psalm 23 may have cued the proverb, spare the rod, spoil the child, to begin to stomp through your brain. Maybe it kicked up the dust of memories of soap in your mouth and a belt on your behind. Hmm. Or maybe that's just me. Don't worry. You're not about to read a whole manipulative chapter asking you to consider how all the hard things that have happened to you are just God's good rod of discipline. This line of Psalm 23 is not a baptism of brutality as kindness. The Lord disciplines the one he loves. But this psalm's immediate context is the shepherd's readiness to protect and guide the vulnerable sheep in his care. Mm. Sheep have almost no ability to protect themselves from predators. Even when they survive an attack and avoid sustaining injury, they can still die from panic. As grazing animals, sheep have an innate instinct to seek protection by banding together and running from danger. They have sharp peripheral vision with slit-shaped horizontal pupils that allow them to see behind themselves without fully turning their heads, enabling them to scan for danger better than you or I ever could. But other than being able to deliver a swift kick to anyone who gets too close to their lambs, sheep entirely depend on their shepherd to protect them from harm. A shepherd's rod and staff have historically been used to protect the flock and guide them into safety, not as tools for punishing them for their vulnerabilities. The staff is used as an extension of the shepherd's voice, lightly tapping the shoulders or laying the staff across the side of a special sheep as though to say, "I'm here." Mm. Likewise, in traditional shepherding context, the rod is the shepherd's primary offensive weapon for protecting the flock from enemies, be they wild animals or human thieves. While the rod is mentioned in other parts of Scripture to describe discipline, in the context of a shepherd's attentive care, the rod's primary purpose is protecting the vulnerable sheep against external threats. She goes on to say a little bit later, she's talking about, it's just taking everything I have in me not to just read all of this to you.
Keep reading. It's so good.
She's talking about David and Goliath.
This is what happens at night sometimes on Voxer. Fran will say, "I'm going to read to you."
This is story time,
story
everyone.
Story time with Fran.
But this is just, it's so powerful and beautiful of the shepherd, and it's powerful and beautiful of the rod and what it's meant to do. Okay, I'm going to keep reading.
Keep reading.
Okay. When Israel was fighting the Philistines, their enemy sent out a giant named Goliath to defeat them. Goliath towered outside the Israelite camp, taunting them. "Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us." The Israelite army and their king Saul spent 40 days straight, quaking in their tents, terrified of Goliath and the imminent enslavement he had threatened. That's when David, just a boy, showed up with some food from home for his brothers in the army. As he was catching up with them, Goliath's voice thundered out over the valley with his daily display of defiance. Every time Goliath taunted, the Israelites fled in terror. Like sheep without a shepherd to reassure them, the Israelites had the same flight instinct as terrified sheep. But David, he hated the way Goliath was shaming the armies of the living God. His oldest brother scoffed at him, calling David conceited for coming to the battle just to watch, as though David was shirking his shepherding duties at home. But his brother's shaming did not stop him. David kept saying that someone needed to stand up to Goliath and kept speaking up until someone told King Saul about the boy and his bravery. Saul sent for David, and when David arrived at the king's tent, he volunteered himself for the task none of the grown men were willing to do. "Let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine," David said. "Your servant will go and fight him." Saul probably looked him up and down in disbelief. Compared with a giant, David's stature was nothing. Saul wasn't about to shame the whole army and himself by sending out someone impossibly young. I wrote gorgeous beside this next section, this next few sentences. David defended his courage with his history of shepherding. Mm. He told Saul how he'd tended sheep for his father, how whenever a bear or a lion came to take a lamb from his flock, he'd run it down, strike it with his rod, and deliver the lamb out of his mouth. King Saul's eyes had been full of fear for 40 days, and I imagine David looking into them with his own fierce, clear eye saying, "Look, lion or bear, it didn't matter. I killed it. It was after my sheep, and I did what needed to be done to protect them. And I'll do the same to this Philistine pig who is after the army of the living God." Theologian N.T. Wright says, he has written that virtue is what happens when courageous choices have been practiced so repeatedly they become our instinct. Courage is what happens when we've made 1,000 small, hard choices requiring our attention and effort, risking embarrassment and even failure to honor the vulnerable within our care, including the vulnerability within our own souls. Courage is what comes out of you when you've practiced standing up to the giants of shame, lions of lies, and bears of brokenness so repeatedly that it becomes second nature. The truth is, David's courage wasn't just his audacity to believe God would save him that day. It was every choice he made to become the kind of person who would risk believing it. This is the last thing. Courage is the practice of wanting to protect. It's that same word, protect. Mm-hmm. Courage is the practice of wanting to protect what is good and true and beautiful more than we want to avoid being wounded.
Wow.
Courage is not the absence of anxiety, but the practice of trusting that we will be held and loved no matter what happens. And you go back to remembering that the shepherd's rod and staff have historically been used to protect the flock and guide them into safety, not as tools for punishing them for their vulnerability. So in the context of this psalm, it makes sense why it says, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. It is for good.
Wow, that will preach.
Yeah, and that's what makes this book. I mean, this chapter is just a few. I mean, it's literally 6 pages long, but it's just so rich mm-hmm. and deep that you can't just skim and read it and go, oh, that's great.
You have to sit in it.
You got to sit in it, and you got to think on it. And so I don't know. I think this book truly just would minister to somebody's
Absolutely.
Soul.
Absolutely. I loved it when the author said that they can still die from panic.
Yeah.
Think about all the panic and anxiety. Like, mm-hmm. we are those sheep.
Yeah, we are.
And there's a reason he chose a sheep mm-hmm. to compare us to, and right. the shepherd of the sheep.
Right.
When you really dig into all that.
Yeah, so anyway, highly recommended. It's called The Lord Is My Courage by K.J. Ramsey. I think it is a must read for every... Oh, I just dropped it. For everybody, mm-hmm. if it's in the right context of your life.
And then if there's anybody that's just really struggling with grief and suffering in a deeper way or a more personal way, there's a companion when I went to order that book. And the title almost kind of made me laugh, like not in a funny way, but it tickled me a little because my grandmother always said, "This too shall pass."
Yes.
The title of the other book by this author is "This Too Shall Last."
Yes.
And I just kind of laughed like, well, great.
I know.
that sounds very uplifting.
Yes.
But here's the thing. If you are sitting in a season of grieving a spouse, for example, mm-hmm. you're not going to care about a book that just says, well, maybe tomorrow you'll stop thinking about it and get over it. That's right. never going to happen.
Right.
But that author is just so good. And I think her context was maybe an illness, an ongoing illness. I don't remember. But just anybody that's dealing with something hard, lament mm-hmm. is scriptural. Mm-hmm. You know, we can be mm-hmm. real quick to just kind of push past or give mm-hmm. these platitudes mm-hmm. or, you know, we'll keep going mm-hmm. or say these little encouraging mm-hmm. things that almost sound like we don't really grasp and understand mm-hmm. and are caring enough to sit in that pain with them.
And I think, too, like Psalm 23 is so familiar to people, but they don't understand it. I've never mm-hmm. been taught fully what it means. And so... Sometimes those very familiar passages, very familiar chapters, you just read them and they don't tend to your soul like they should. Mm-hmm. So the fact that she takes us through this book so slowly mm-hmm. is beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. And it just reminds me of the power and the beauty of leaning in to the grace of God that he gives us. That because I wonder a lot, like when people are going through something hard, whatever it is, and somebody gets on the other side of it really well or goes through the process really well, and then somebody else doesn't. The grace of God is always there for mm-hmm. everybody. And it's like, what is the difference? Mm-hmm. What's the difference in how I walk through or you walk through or respond to or navigate this suffering, and it's okay. It's tolerable. It's manageable. You're not running from it. You are aware of maybe even your role in it. I don't know, but that's a mystery. I don't know that we'll ever understand, like, why did some people not make it to the other side well, and some did, is was God's not withholding his grace and his desire to see you through. Was that my fault? Was that something that I didn't do right or well? I don't know. I think it's just a mystery of all of it. But I just was reminded as I read this to lean into the truth of Scripture, and that's where you find God's grace and who he really is. His character just ministers to you, and it's just beautiful.
I love it. Well, we can never go wrong seeing people, meeting them where they are, and pointing them to Jesus.
Yeah.
It's just so good.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway,
you accidentally created a gift guide that we said we wouldn't do.
Y'all, I ain't about a gift guide because I still, unless you want some Lululemon men's pants, that's all I got with this book.
Do you have any thoughts about the beginning of the year coming up or how you want to spend the break just in your own time with the Lord? Like, what's that going to look like? And as we turn the corner, start a new fresh year. Have you even thought that far ahead yet?
Well, I think like everybody, I think just in the Christmas season, I don't know. I have no idea. Maybe this is just me, but I bet a lot of people use this season, especially probably the week between Christmas and New Year's.
Can we just say, I love that week more than any other week. 100%. You don't know what day it is. Mm-hmm. You don't know what time it is. Mm-hmm. You just eat and wear fat pants, and I always take off work and just...
It's lovely.
I become a bear. I guess that's hibernation.
I love it.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
But I love to just reflect on my relationship with the Lord. That's why that journal, that prayer journal comes in just beautifully at the end of the year. I spend time to reflect back on all that he and I have gone through together. And
do you go back through the pages?
Oh, for sure. Read it, highlight things, because I want to know, I still need to pray for that. That's still an unanswered prayer. I've forgotten that. Or, look at what he's done, and I just haven't been able to connect the dots. So it reads like a book, and I love to spend that time just reflecting on who the Lord is to me personally, where we've been together this past year, and also in the life of my family and just all the people that mean so much to me. But I think, how can you skip past Christmas without reflecting on who your Savior is to you personally?
Mm-hmm. No, that's good. I'm ready for it.
It's sweet.
Such a just, we're still in that chaotic, like my work schedule is just bonkers the next couple of weeks.
And no time for this kind of deep reflecting.
But it's coming. I will make complete sentences again.
Yeah.
This morning I ran out the door and I was just so frustrated because I wanted more time than I had. My sons had to go in earlier and had tutoring and all the things. And I was a little bit, I don't know if angry, that's kind of aggressive.
Frustrated.
But I was very frustrated because I wanted some me time, but it's coming.
Right. And y'all just remember, don't get legalistic in that. The Lord can be built into your day all day, every day.
Well,
not just the morning, not just the night, but at 2 p.m. and 11:15 and 6:20.
Well, I have a funny and also telling off on myself and because I didn't even connect that until I just looked at it in my notes a second ago. Last night, I was, and it's even on here, 8:49 last night, I was in a sweet place of rest and relaxation. I'd had two naps before 8 o'clock last night. Let me just throw that in there. I told my husband I got carry out. I wanted to get on the couch, watch something good on TV. I had taken two naps by 8 o'clock. We watched Firefly Lane a little bit off and on. Mm-hmm. I'll have to watch it again. I slept through half of it. I don't regret it. It was wonderful. But I was on Instagram and on the Daily Grace Co. We've talked about them in the past. They had something that they posted, and I thought, this is so fantastic.
This is so great.
For the listeners. Okay, I'm pointing both fingers at myself because literally on the heels of what I just said, I want y'all to hear what I saved for you all to benefit from.
What's also so funny about this is that how many times do you say out loud to me and to others, be still. Be still and know. Be still.
We've said that a lot this year. I have said that a lot this year. The Lord has had me in that. Guess what? I think it's for my own need to listen to these words. Okay, so here's what the Daily Grace Co. posted. Being still isn't about a relaxing morning. It's about resting our anxious hearts.
Yeah, well, how about that, Miss Snyder?
I got so worked up this morning. I literally, when I calmed down, when I got to work and settled in and had my appointments and was in between meetings and podcasts on our lunch hour, I called my husband and I said, I realized I sounded like a fool this morning. I'm better now.
You know what's so crazy is that when you do spend like, I don't know what your time with the Lord was, but
this,
you know,
morning it was like 5 minutes, and
but
I was not okay with that.
5 minutes or 55 minutes, you can come out of that time, and mm-hmm. 6 minutes later, you're just acting like a fool.
Yes.
It's like, good gosh.
Yes.
Our humanity, our humanness is just ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. So it's not about a relaxing morning. It's about resting our anxious hearts. Mm-hmm. And in the caption, she said, I love the words, be still. But sometimes I worry we equate them more with relaxing in the morning mm-hmm. than with a heart at rest.
Mm-hmm.
What does it really, truly mean to be still? And like Fran just said, we've talked about Psalm 46 a lot on this podcast. And that command to be still and know that He is God.
Know that He is God.
And
you are not.
No, exactly. I'm not Jesus Jr. And in the Hebrew lexicon, she said, I learned something interesting. To be still means to let go,
mm-hmm.
to let something fall from your hands, to relax your grip.
Called control. This is all uh-huh. a control
and,
thing.
And I promise y'all, on the way to work this morning, I was so worked up. I was probably gripping that steering wheel and clenching my teeth. I'll probably have sore teeth because of how worked up I got. It was a good reminder to me that I can let go of my own plans and embrace the Lord's plan, mm. knowing He will hold me through it all. I can relax my white knuckle grip. Like, clearly I needed this. I can stop doing it my way and trust that His way is perfect. I can stop doing it in my own strength. I can abide. Mm-hmm. Remember when my mm-hmm. word of the year was
mm-hmm.
abide?
Mm-hmm. Look what good that did you.
Uh-huh. I can abide in Him. He is God. I don't have to be.
Well, it just all, everything, every single day, we say this all the time. And everybody understands and agrees that, you know, we wake up and we surrender and then we take control back mm-hmm. and then we surrender and we take
surrender was my word 2 years ago. It was abide and it was surrender.
As Dr. Dub says, mm-hmm. our word should always just mm-hmm. be Jesus.
We're listening, Dr. Dub. I will continue to choose a word, I bet, because I'm just who I am. But my word will also always be Jesus.
Okay, what else do we need to talk about?
You know, I don't know. That's a lot. I do. Yeah, we could carol. I do think, you know, on the heels of some of the things you read in that book and just the conversation that you and I have had all week, I've met with some people in several contexts, through work, through friendships, who are struggling a little bit with other people.
Well, what do you mean by that exactly?
And well, I think this is going to apply universally because all of us are going to be with families, which can be fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
There can also be some expectations mm-hmm. of, yay, postcard, picture-perfect family.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get around the table, and it's just not what you wanted necessarily.
Listen, we should just stop right there. And I think if you're listening to this ahead of Christmas, you need to be very clear on what your expectation mm-hmm. is and bring that down about 100 notches.
That's great
Unless
advice.
You're very honest and you know that my expectation is low. And that's okay because as moms, mm-hmm. especially, we create these scenarios, these images, these opportunities, these conversations, mm-hmm. these moments that we just are all Pinteresty in our little head.
Mm-hmm.
And then the reality is, well, they were not that at all.
Mm-hmm. And it's more common than not.
Mm-hmm.
The people that are intimidating to you on social media because mm-hmm. everything looks perfect—
mm-hmm.
most of the time, those are the people struggling the most.
Yeah.
And then they're creating, you know, anyway, let's just keep it real, people. But in the conversations I've had counseling with some people in various contexts, one thing I'm hearing is, people are saying, you know, if we want to learn and grow in our relationship with the Lord and who He has called us to be, we don't need to stay the same.
Right.
He is leveling us up. We talk about leveling up, growing us up, and growing pains hurt.
Well, sure they do.
So part of the growing pains, you know, as I'm, it's funny, as I listen to people, then I go back later and think about it and realize I'm that person too. You know, just like I gave a wonderful example a few minutes ago on the podcast. But I think as we realize, you know, it's real easy to point the finger at somebody else, but as part of our growth and maturity, mm-hmm. I told somebody yesterday, you can never go wrong by being humble and teachable and being the first one to own whatever your part is.
Right.
And we're going to bump up against people. We're not all going to get along perfectly well.
And we don't understand what growth is going to look like in mm-hmm. other people's lives. And so growing is good. I mean, mm-hmm. you think about anything that grows, a flower, you know, anything out of a garden that is of benefit, it doesn't always look great. Mm-hmm. You can't see what the end product is going to be, but growth is good. And we just get irritated when that growth bumps up against us and we don't understand it. Mm-hmm. We can't see it for what it is. And so it hurts us.
The big picture.
Yeah.
I think it was in the daily Bible verse. I think it was in this past week in one of the devotions on the Bible app. But it talked about the lobster. Did you see that one?
I don't know.
It wasn't in the video, but there was a devotion. And it talked about how when lobsters grow a new, harder shell.
Yes, I do remember that.
You remember that?
Yes.
And there's a period of pain, like the old shell has to fall off. Right. And then they're vulnerable. And then the new shell mm-hmm. is grown. It was just mm-hmm. such a sweet picture.
Well, and as we are image bearers, we need to be gracious mm-hmm. and patient and supportive, because a lot of people don't understand when they're growing. They don't have maybe an Angela or myself beside them to help them see what's going on. And so without healthy, proper community and conversation and just keeping the perspective and bringing wisdom into the scenario, it can just all be so irritating.
Mm-hmm.
And as image bearers, especially for anybody that is older and has lived enough life with the Lord and the world, then, you know, you can be gracious, and you can teach others how to be gracious and loving and supportive, because so much of the time, Angela, we make it about ourselves.
Like, it's all the time.
It has become about us
mm-hmm.
and our thoughts and our feelings and what we think should be happening, when it's like, oh, hang on a minute. So you just think about your own kids.
Mm-hmm.
We want to control their growth. We want to move that growth. We want to be in charge of that growth. We want to navigate that growth, and we cannot do it. We have to let them suffer. We have to let them endure. We have to let them figure things out. We have to let them fall. We have to let them seek counsel or not seek counsel. But we come alongside them anyway and help them and support them and love them and do all those good things, but we can't control anybody's growth, and we sure as heck can't understand what the Lord's doing.
That's so true. It's just good. It's just a good reminder.
Love your people well.
And love them where they are.
Love them where they are.
Expectations.
Even Christmas.
Control your expectations. And, you know, one of our favorite prayers that we talk about is DFW, mm-hmm. discernment, favor, and wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
If you ask the Lord to give you discernment
mm-hmm.
into your relationships mm-hmm. with people, give you favor,
mm-hmm.
and then give you wisdom,
mm-hmm.
open your eyes to see maybe there's a perspective that they don't have because they haven't had the same life experience you've had. Or maybe they've had, you know, some trauma that you don't even know about that is framed the way they see the world. But if we could just show some grace and some humility.
Yeah.
Never go wrong with that. Preaching to myself. So, okay. So we're going to have one more podcast episode before Christmas.
I know.
And I'm excited about that because I'm going to share something I've learned through the context of one of my favorite Christmas albums, and it helped me see Christmas in a totally different light.
Okay.
So I want to talk about that next time, and then no telling what else we'll have to say.
No, listen, who knows?
Who knows?
We'll talk about baby Jesus.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
The reason for the season.
Fran might also sing.
No, I won't sing, but thank you for your grace as I read to you from this book. I know that can just
beautiful.
Be like, oh my gosh. But so I think this time of year, remembering who your shepherd is, remembering that you are a sheep and how much he loves you and how much he wants to protect you and guide you and comfort you. He is for you. But when you're in the middle of something difficult, that seems very hard
mm-hmm.
to get your mind wrapped around. So get your mind and your heart wrapped around the truth of Scripture, and that's where the tending to the healing will really start to take place. And anyway, Thank you for letting me read to you for story time today.
I love the image that the rod and the staff are for us. They're and for not us. Opposed to us.
Yeah, because if you don't know the context of how the rod is used in any particular scripture, it's you scary. Think it is like, eek, here
especially
he comes.
If you've had some hard discipline That's issues right. in your past or, right. Or daddy issues in any kind of way.
That's right.
This was good. I wish you would just read, like, the Bible to me. No, that's kind of ambitious. The Fran reading. We'll put you on Audible, Fran.
Listen, that would be the Southern version. Mm-hmm. Which version would you like?
Message us if you want the Fran edition of any book or any Bible read to you. We'll get right on that.
Oh, y'all, let us know how your Christmas shopping is doing. Yes. Be kind as you are out and about. Thanks for listening to episode 92. Merry Christmas, everybody. Fa-la-la-la-la.
La 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 la.
La 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 la. Have a great day. We'll see you next week. That was fun and easy listening, wasn't it? Sometimes in December, you just don't need to use your brain a whole lot. Everything we talked about is in the show notes, so be sure and look for that on your podcast listening platform. Okay? If you have any questions, always DM us. You know you can find us on Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, and yes, TikTok. We love you. Have a wonderful day. We're praying for you as you go out and about enjoying this Christmas season. See you next week.